Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome to worship this morning. We're gathered for a service of the Word. We're following Divine Service Setting Number 3 out of the Lutheran Service Book this morning. And this is also the quarterly meeting, and we invite you to stay after the service for the business at hand for the congregation. A few additions to our prayer list this morning. Debbie Freeman, who is our preschool aide, was in an auto accident last week, and she broke a couple of ribs, so we pray for her recovery from that injury. Added to our prayer list is Owen Toll, who is suffering from cancer. He formerly worked with Norma Huth. And also Arlene and Jen Bush have been added to our prayer list. I'm not sure what the reason for that is, but we will hold them in prayer as well. Let us now stand as we begin our worship, singing hymn 842, Son of God, Eternal Savior. Our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
When you forgave the iniquity of my sin.
merciful Father,
I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful me.
Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers.
But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night.
He is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, he prospers.
The wicked are not so, but are like chaff that the wind drives away.
Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous.
For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Thank you.
many dangers that in our frailty we cannot stand upright. Grant strength and protection to support us in all dangers and carry us through all temptations. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The Old Testament reading today is found in Micah chapter 6, beginning at verse 1. Hear what the Lord says. Arise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear before your voice. Hear your mountains, the indictment of the Lord, and you will be an enduring foundations of the earth. For the Lord has an indictment against his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what shall I have done to you? How have I wearied you? Answer me, for I brought you up from the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of slavery. And I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember the Balak, the king of Moab, devised, and what Balaam, the son of Beor, answered him, and what happened from Shion and Gilgal, that you may know the saving acts of the Lord. What shall I come before the Lord and bow before myself, before God on high? Shall I come before him with the burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams and with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? But do justice, and to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle today is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, beginning at verse 18. The word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since, in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, it has pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks seek wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and a folly to the Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For wisdom you are calling, brothers. Not many of you are wise according to worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were noble of birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to save the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring nothing things that are, so that human being might boast in the presence of God. He is the source of your life in Jesus Christ, whom God made our wisdom and our righteousness and sanctification and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We stand as we sing the Alleluias. Seeing the crowd, once, Jesus went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." This is the gospel of the Lord. Speaking together the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Congregation, please be seated as we sing hymn 848, Lord, whose love through humble service.
Thank you.
grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The text for the sermon this morning is the Old Testament reading, the reading from the prophet Micah. Perhaps you recognize a little bit of this reading from Micah from the Good Friday service as one of the three reproaches the Lord makes against his people. That's the part of the service where God rhetorically asks his people of Israel, in a sense, and these are my words, "Why have you, my people, returned evil for all the good that I've done for you? You are my chosen people. I have fed you, I have freed you, I protected you and guided you through all of your lives, and yet you repay me with disobedience, lukewarm worship, and finally, with the crucifixion of my only begotten Son." Well, the Jewish people of Micah's time, as well as the Jewish people of Jesus' time, would have replied to that, "Well, what do you mean by that, Lord? We hold your word to be sacred. It is the very backbone of our society. Your law is what our people's moral code is built on." And so it is today for both Jewish and Christian societies. That's where the term the Judeo-Christian ethic came from. The things that we hold to be right and decent and proper come from God's word of Scripture. And the things that we hold to be indecent and immoral, at least until recent decades, are the things condemned by the Lord in his holy word. Back in the late 1960s, the folk group Crosby, Stills, and Nash had a song called "Teach Your Children Well." And it began with an imperative statement: "You, who are on the road, must have a code that you can live by." Now, I'm assuming that they're talking about the way of life that we hand down to our children as they grow to become adults on their own. We're talking about ethics. Ethics are the standards that we proclaim to be our guiding principles. But the problem of living by a code of ethics is that even though they may be divinely wise, we are the ones who have the job of living according to them. And we're sinners by nature. We're flawed. We're broken. So the best that we can really do is to intend to live to the higher standard that we put before ourselves. When Lori and I were young parents, we hung an emblem at the top of our front door of our house that quoted the book of Joshua chapter 24, and it said, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." Now, we're far from being the only people that have done that, but it was a grand gesture of our desire to be faithful people. To be faithful as individuals, as a husband and wife, and as parents of a young family. That was who we wanted to be. Not necessarily perfect, but all in all dedicated to serving God and to following Jesus as his disciples. So you might wonder, how did we do? Well, I would say, better than some, not nearly as good as others. We were steady worshipers, and we brought our children to church and to Sunday school. When we argued, we repented of our selfishness, and we forgave each other. We tried to be generous to the less fortunate. We gradually increased our offerings to get to the level of tithing. And we looked for opportunities to share the gospel with those in our lives. But to be truthful, we weren't all that markedly different from the people who lived around us. They obeyed the law probably as well as we did. They seemed to be just as friendly and neighborly as we were. Their children behaved just as well or poorly as ours did. And some were involved in community groups and gave to charities that helped people in need. Which kind of makes you wonder, what exactly is the difference between a Christian home Surveys of American homes show that the opinions and the behaviors that come from Christian households don't necessarily reflect a great difference from those of unbelievers. The divorce rates aren't greatly different. The opinions on social issues aren't really that different. The amount of trouble that kids get into isn't that very different between those households. So we make a big mistake if we think we can present our lives to God as if they were some resume of righteous living. As a matter of fact, by doing that, we fall into Israel's sin when we think that what we do for the Lord is something that builds a case for our justification in God's eyes. The Lord's case against Israel at the time of the prophet Micah is that they honor him with their lips, but in everyday life, they are presenting God with worthless offerings because their hearts just are not in them. They actually weary the Lord with their petty selfishness. They lie to each other. They sell in the marketplace with crooked scales. They use violence against their neighbors, and they're willing to worship idols if they think that will enhance their success in life. Israel treats God as if he were a creditor who needs to be appeased. Well, we fall into that very same sin when we treat worship as an obligation, something that needs to be checked off our weekly list. We do it when we wear a cross around our neck, but have to be reminded of who needs the salvation that he won for us there. Or when we demand for more blessings from God before we'll offer him our worship and our praise. It is the height of arrogance when we take aim at some minimum threshold of doing good things for God. Because in truth, we don't supply God with anything that he needs, except for genuine love and devotion. And if we truly love God, we'll direct that love and devotion to his creation and to his creatures, our fellow sinners in need of grace and forgiveness. So I guess we ask the same question that Israel asks in this reading. What is the good that we must do? Well, it surely is not stingy offerings that we give begrudgingly. The answer, at the end of our reading this morning, is but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. That's the very life that we were made for. This is the path that we're directed to walk through this life, and not just sometimes, not just sporadic acts of kindness in between stretches of hard-heartedness. We do good to God when we do good to our neighbors, because he loves them as much as he loves us, enough to redeem them from the slavery of sin and death. But what does God do when he looks down and he sees that we are not living with pure hearts? What hope can we have if we love our IRAs and our 401ks and our property values more than we love our starving neighbor across the town or across the world? Well, God rebukes our sin, and he sends his son into the world to do something wonderful. So the prophet Micah reminds us of just some of God's love shown to his people in need. And Micah recounts, God rescued the people of Israel when they were enslaved in Egypt. And he gave them faithful leaders in Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. And then he delivered them from the evil schemes of King Balak. And all of these were merely foreshadowing of what God was in the process of doing for them and for the whole world. And that was sending Jesus to be our Savior. Jesus came, we remember, not to condemn the world, but to save it. He came and he did exactly what we're supposed to do. For his mercy faced to those facing sickness and death. For his generosity to those without their daily bread. For his turning the other cheek in humility when anger would most certainly be our prescription against mistreatment. Sometimes parents make the mistake of comparing their misbehaved children to the seemingly perfect examples around them. And often, that only breeds resentment and jealousy. So that is not why God sent his beloved Son into our world. Jesus did not come to compel us to do the things that God requires us to do. He came to do them. And then to erase his indictment against us. That's right. The justice, the loving kindness, the humble walking with his Heavenly Father, all of the good things that we ought to be doing, Jesus did for us. And he did it by living and loving us to the end. By suffering at the hands of men. By enduring God's righteous judgment in our place. And by rising and ascending to be our advocate. And then by sending us his Holy Spirit, our strength and our comforter, in faith when we're drawn to Jesus, and in Jesus we are made new creations. It's all about redemption. Redemption is how God changes hearts. Because the law, as holy as it is, cannot make us holy. Not by coercion, not by exertion. This law of God teaches us, and it is what compels us to do what is good. But only God's gospel of grace really frees us to do what is precious in God's sight. And it begins with trusting in him and not in the world around us. And it lives in that love we call agape love. And that is the love that delights in God's justice with humility and with service. Jesus is the one who has done that. His work of atonement was completed when he said on the cross, "It is finished. Done." When you remember why you are precious in God's sight, when the Holy Spirit calls you by the gospel, enlightens you with his gifts, and then sanctifies and keeps you in the faith, your delight will be in doing justice to God's other children. Israel disappointed God time and time again, but he still loved them. Clearly, it was not for the value of their sacrifices. It wasn't for all the rams and all the oil that they brought to God's altar. God has loved them, and he has loved us. Not for our sterling achievements, not for anything that we have done, but so that in Christ and by the power of the Holy Spirit, we can truly love and delight in what is good for our neighbors. That's what humble faith in God empowers us to do by the power of Jesus. Amen. Congregation, please stand as we sing the offer.
Thank you.
set aside his indictment against our sin and forgive us for Jesus' sake. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the wisdom of God, that we would not confess the wisdom of men, but boldly proclaim Christ and him crucified for the salvation of the world. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For meekness, that we would be delivered from stubborn hearts and gladly submit to God's holy will. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For parents, that the Lord who gave his firstborn for our sins would strengthen them to teach their children his ways and to rejoice in his grace rather than to embrace the sins of their forebears. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For peace, that the Lord who led his people past Pharaoh and Balak would provide wise rulers to the nations and protect us from tyranny. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those reviled and slandered on account of Jesus, that the Lord would preserve them and ceaselessly give them joy and gladness, that their reward in heaven would be great. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For help in affliction, especially for Bill Ayler, Sharon Ayler, Kevin Bruning, Arlene and Jen Bush, Pastor Donnelly, Nancy Forbes, Debbie Freeman, Denise Jambroni, Dorothy Haas, Marilyn Hollenbeck, Peter Booth, Norma Booth, Charlie Landau, Dylan Maines, Mike Baker, Jan Noack, Emma, Christine Pickard, Darwin Pope, Aliana Randlin, Norma Raybould, Tom Roll, Nancy Smith, Joe Zemanski, Owen Toll, and Janet Gregg. That the Lord, who chooses what is weak in the world to shame the strong, would use infirmities for our good until he delivers those who suffer them. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord God, Heavenly Father, receive our thanks for the saints whom you preserved in righteousness and delivered to glory. Purify our hearts by your grace and strengthen us against temptation, that we would look joyfully to the day when we will see you in glory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. O God, your infinite love restores to the right way those who err, seeks the scattered, and preserves those whom you have gathered. Of your tender mercy, pour out on your faithful people the grace of unity, that all schisms be ended, your flock may be gathered to the true shepherd of your church, and may serve you in all faithfulness. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.